Elizabeth had seen, at close hand, the fates of her father's wives. Their main task had been to produce a male heir. When they failed, he'd simply cast them to one side. More and more, her virginity seemed to secure her personal power.
But that power was still under threat from Elizabeth's Catholic cousin, Mary, the Queen of Scots. Mary had fled to England after the murder of her husband, in which she was implicated. Now she became the rallying point for English Catholics. Throughout the land, a network of priests set about undermining the authority of Elizabeth.
Francis Walsingham, her determined chief of intelligence, undertook to crush the Catholic priests. He had 22 of them burnt at the stake for assisting the campaign. Elizabeth approved.
In an age that was characterized by excesses of religious bigotry, Elizabeth was no soft touch. Her main victims were English members of the Society of Jesus, whose doctrines could sanction the assassination of a monarch. One of those arrested and put to torture here in the Tower of London was a Father Henry Walpole. And here on the walls we can still see the marks that he made before his eventual martyrdom.
As princess, Elizabeth had been the rallying point for disaffected Protestants. She'd been accused of treason and sent to the Tower. Now the boot was on the other foot. Elizabeth had been spared. But would she be as merciful to her cousin, Mary? Walsingham was clear. There would be no peace until Mary was gone. So he set about entrapping her once and for all, intercepting letters from the Catholic plotters who backed her.
In 1586, Mary was tried and found guilty of treason against England. Elizabeth hesitated fully 3 months before signing the death warrant. But finally, Mary, Queen of Scots, was led into the Great Hall of Fotheringay Castle in Northamptonshire and executed. It took 3 blows to sever her head.
When Elizabeth got the news of Mary's death, she felt pangs of guilt about executing another queen. She blamed everyone around her, but not herself. Yet the Catholic threat had still not gone away. A year after Mary's execution, Elizabeth faced the biggest test of her reign. The Spanish Armada was sent by King Philip, Elizabeth's step-brother-in-law. He saw Protestant Elizabeth as ruler of a rogue state and planned to bring her into line.
While the English and the Spanish forces fought running skirmishes out at sea, Elizabeth gathered her army here at Tilbury with the aim of blocking a Spanish invasion from the European mainland. But her troops were inexperienced. They were terrified. For this, the climactic moment of her reign, Elizabeth summoned her most stirring rhetoric, and she put in the performance of a lifetime.
I am come amongst you, as you see, at this time, not for my recreation and disport, but being resolved in the midst of heat and battle to live and die amongst you all. To lay down for my God and for my kingdom and my people, my honour and my blood, even in the dust. I know I have the body of a weak and feeble woman, but I have the heart and stomach of a king, and a king of England too.
The speech and the scene couldn't have been scripted better by Shakespeare himself. Instead of taking shelter in one of her stately homes, Elizabeth had come here to mingle with her soldiers.
Elizabeth had resisted marriage, insurrection, and invasion. After the Armada's defeat, she was the heroine, and the people adored her. The biggest crisis of her reign was over.
Elizabeth reigned for another 15 years, remaining single and childless. Abroad, her empire flourished, thanks to buccaneering spirits such as Walter Raleigh and Francis Drake, who made increasingly aggressive forays across the Atlantic. But at home, as she herself became difficult and indecisive, the cracks in her domestic realm were beginning to show.
7 years of famine and an outbreak of smallpox had caused terrible hardship. 40% of the population were living in severe poverty. Begging had become a serious problem. And there was starvation, especially in the more remote parts of the country. Elizabeth felt her own gloom too. In February of 1603, one of her greatest friends, the Countess of Nottingham, died. Elizabeth sank into a deep depression. She stopped eating. She spent her days lying on the floor on cushions, lost in unremovable melancholy. And finally, she was persuaded to take to her bed.
Her advisors urged her to name a successor, but by now Elizabeth was beyond speech. Later, they claimed that she'd made the sign of a crown above her head. They took this to mean that she wanted James, King of Scotland, to succeed her.
In the early hours of Thursday, the 24th of March, 1603, she died. The sapphire ring on her finger was removed. It was dropped from a window to a messenger below, waiting to take it to the next heir. King James VI of Scotland was about to become King James I of England. It was the Virgin Queen's final legacy. For the first time, England and Scotland would be joined under one crown.
Halfway through Elizabeth's reign, a new pope, Sixtus V, remarked admiringly, "She's only a woman, and she rules only half of an island. But see how well she governs. Spain fears her, France fears her, we all fear her." Well, many mysteries still remain about the person of Elizabeth. And it's true that she was never short of enemies, but her success was always undeniable. She was, quite simply, the miracle of her age. And that is why an entire epoch in her honour is dubbed as the Elizabethan Age.